The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome back once again. Thank you to Greg Proops and Senator Chuck Schumer for answering your phone. Elizabeth Warren in 2020 and Elizabeth Warren for Senate Minority Leader.
We can't hear.
You don't need to hear.
It stopped.
You can take your cans off. Okay. You can take your heads.
We're recording though?
Yeah, we're recording.
Okay. We just ruined everything.
That's my friend Kristen Buckels, who's a hysterical comedian and comedy writer and producer. She produces stage shows for Colin Quinn, Nick Kroll, and John Mulaney. She's also the creator of Between Two Bushes. What is Between Two Bushes? You don't need your headset. What is Between Two Bushes? You don't need the headset.
I know, but Alex said I should, so I'm going to do it because I want to make Alex's day better.
Okay, what is Between Two Bushes?
Between Two Bushes is a sketch group. We do stand-up and sketch with my partner Lacey Jekka and I. Mm-hmm. And we are the Bushes of Between Two Bushes.
I know Lacey.
Lacey's the best.
And you're very funny.
Thank you so much.
And Dave Sirus.
Hi.
Coming back over and over again, I hope. Brilliant comedy writer, has written for SNL, Triumph the Incel Comic Dogs specials, and you're a brilliant writer. It's hard to get you to come out of your shell. He's very shy, Dave.
Dave murdered somebody on the way here.
Yeah, nominated for Emmys, and you are a YouTube star under another name, right?
Brickstone, yeah. That's why I used to do a web series where I would go to hate groups and try to piss them off enough to stop whatever they were doing.
Mostly you succeeded. You did really
sometimes,
well.
Sometimes, yeah.
You've really succeeded. Thank you for your great work.
They really did not like me.
Trump's president now. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Well, at least, you know.
What a great opportunity.
Well, I can't take responsibility for it, but I can say that Westboro Baptist Church is effectively redundant now.
Yeah. I'll defend the Westboro Baptist Church.
Now?
Well, I like them. I do.
You're a fan of Westboro.
I've done...
This doesn't surprise me.
I've done several comedy shows where we've gone up against them. First of all, the guy who runs it is a lawyer, and he's a champion of the...
A prosecutor, I assume.
Well, he's a lawyer.
He was a defense attorney for the Democrats in the 60s.
I did not know that.
Though his son specifically said it was purely about trying to take advantage of the time and make money off of civil rights, and that he, of course, in his private life was a virulent racist, but was an opportunist during the civil rights era.
Okay.
Here's the thing about the Westboro Baptist Church. They're the least of our worries.
And
quite frankly... And don't take this the wrong way. They have the courage to stand at a soldier's funeral and hold up God hates F words.
Wow. And that does take a certain amount of courage.
It really does. And Hell's Angels want to beat them up, and families want to beat them up. And yes, it's unfair to the families that they have to see that. But if you're going to have a First Amendment in this country, it's not just about burning the flag. It's about going to a soldier's funeral.
Well, there's a reason they're in textbooks about the First Amendment.
That's fair.
Yeah, and we need the First Amendment.
One thing I never thought was that they should not have the right to say what they want to say. My attitude was always, I'm simply using the exact same laws that allow them to do this to them for me to do what I do to the church.
Right.
That's how I always thought.
But they're very pleasant to deal with. They really are.
Oddly enough, often they are, yes.
Were they ever violent with you?
No. The different members have different
They laugh. They're kind of in on the joke. They're not David Duke.
We know we're idiots.
Okay. So I'm just falling in line and manufacturing consent here on the David Feldman show.
Great.
We have to give our fearless leader, our new president, Donald Trump. And by the way, yesterday was...
Dave just died a little inside.
Veterans Day. And you know, I want to thank Donald Trump. for his personal Vietnam.
Mm-hmm. Chlamydia?
Well, did he contract chlamydia in?
Well, I mean, he said he did. Obviously, that doesn't mean it happened.
Oh, he said he contracted
chlamydia.
Wait, when did
he say that?
He made
person?
A joke on Howard Stern about, I didn't go to Vietnam, I was busy. Something about, I'm paraphrasing, something about having sex with women and that my Vietnam was getting either chlamydia or syphilis.
Okay, and we thank him for that.
Mm-hmm.
I hope he got a purple. Somebody did give him a purple heart.
Who
right?
gave him a purple heart?
A veteran.
Really?
Gave
so,
him, and he accepted.
Was he senile?
And he accepted it
because of the
oh
chlamydia.
He accepted the purple heart, and he said, "You know, I always wanted one of these. I always thought I would have gotten one if I had gone to Vietnam." Because he did not know that purple heart specifically meant getting injured. He thought it was just heroism.
He went to military school.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of tough. Right?
He was very athletic there too,
yeah.
Despite the bone spurs that kept him out of Vietnam.
Yeah, but I mean, military school—that's. In many ways, that those guys are bullies. I mean, they could be tougher than the Vietnamese. Kristen Buckels.
Yeah.
Now, let me ask you a question, Alex. I know you're upset. Alex is our producer. And Kristen says you have a beautiful studio here.
We love your studio.
I know you're
He's
upset
crying.
About Donald Trump. Okay? If I ask you if the coffee's ready, because am I being rude by asking you for the coffee? I know that's. Can I? Do you? I mean, I can get up and leave the show, and go get the coffee,
which would be preferable.
Can I be so bold as to ask you for my coffee, please? Is that okay? And then I'll return the favor somehow.
He won't.
Thank you.
Is there milk?
Thank you.
Is there any milk in the house?
There's milk
and.
Do you want some coffee, too?
Yeah. There's
And Dave Sirus, too, would like
yeah,
some?
Yeah, I would also like some coffee since we need Feldman three doesn't cups know how coffee. To be a host.
I don't.
Thank you so much.
Kristen Buckels, I have daughters. And there's a How old are you, if I might ask?
I'm 28.
And how much do you weigh?
I weigh.
So, you see, I can't even. Here's the thing now.
He's about to say he can't keep a straight face when he did that, yet he did.
teasing women now, not a good idea, right?
No, I would like to continue to be teased.
Seriously?
Yes, absolutely.
Because, but is it, it wasn't, I don't know if it, I don't know if it's appropriate.
Because
anymore.
No, you know, I do feel like it is appropriate. And one thing that I will say for Lacey and I, one of our things is that there is an amount of this sort of like feminism handling us with gloves that I find absolutely infuriating.
Can I confess something to you?
Please.
Okay. And I'll confess this to Dave Sirus. I voted for Bernie Sanders.
So, as did I.
Let me clear my here. The number for Planned Parenthood to donate money is 1-800-798-7092 or maybe 7042. But I think it's 7092. 1-800-798-7092 for Planned Parenthood.
I have donated to Planned Parenthood, but I prefer to make my support of them simply by getting women pregnant who don't want to be.
That's an excellent idea.
Right. I just like to encourage them to get more business.
I will say I've had an abortion. I've been to Planned Parenthood, and on my way out, there were, you know, like people out with signs about not killing fetuses and whatever the fuck that they're saying.
Right.
And it is always just sort of I don't think Planned Parenthood is going anywhere. I really don't.
But it's hard. I mean, Texas, you got to go to, you know, Arkansas.
For?
An abortion. I mean, they've made it really hard to get an abortion in Texas.
That's fair. I also feel like if you're from Texas and you voted for Trump, then maybe, you know.
Yeah, but abortions are like divorces. They're hard to get because
so
you'll still get them.
Mm-hmm.
They're worth it. I mean.
And you get them. You try not to get them for the sake of the children.
Would you
might have been my first almost mathematically correct joke all day. How's that coffee coming? I like my coffee the same way I like my women, to win the electoral vote but lose the electoral college.
Aww.
All right, so let me.
Can I say a hacky joke? I like my coffee like I like my women, hot, black, and scalding my genitals.
Jose Arroyo gave me a better version of that I do in my act. I like my women the way I like my coffee, hot Colombian, and all over my lap while I'm driving.
That's fine.
That's better because it implies that it's spilled by spill
right,
the
right.
coffee.
Yeah.
Jose Arroyo gave me that. Great
combat.
Great. Great.
So I was working on a television show where we were at Hillary headquarters the night of the end of America.
The night of the apocalypse.
And I automatically assumed since day one that she was going to be our next president.
Yes.
There was no question that she was going to win because I have faith in America. And we're walking.
You idiot.
I know. We're walking to the Javits Center with Brian Rich, who, you know.
Yeah.
And we're joking, to, you know, quietly, like, this is it for men, you know.
Yeah. How do you feel about retiring as a white man?
Yeah. It's the end of the patriarchy. It's
totally.
It's over. And, you know, there's a little truth to joking. Because I asked you, can I tease you?
Yeah.
So Brian and I are walking, and we're just being a little Trumpian and going, this is it for us. We're white men.
Mm-hmm.
We have to move over. The women are coming for us. And there's a little truth to that. And even President Obama said that a lot of the people, when he was on the campaign trail, he said to the men, come on, admit it, guys. You're a little uncomfortable voting for a woman. Mm-hmm. Admit it to his own support. His speeches, by the way, on the campaign trail should be turned into books. They should be read.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. His speeches were just, you know.
Yeah.
So, and then I'm waiting in line for my press credentials, because if you're a comedy writer in this country, it's easier to get press credentials
than actual press.
Than the actual press. Because, and I said to Brian, a woman was standing in front of us with her daughter. I said, assuming Hillary was going to win,
mm-hmm.
well, it, you know, this is a monumental moment. It just, you know, it proves to my daughter that if you marry the right guy and he becomes president and you keep your mouth shut for 25 years, you too can become president. And this woman turns around.
Oh, no.
This is when I thought she was going to be the president.
Right.
And this woman turns around with her daughter. She goes, little ears. And she scowled at me like she just wanted to get, you know, the pruning shears out and cut it off. And I have to admit that I felt a little hostile towards that.
You got a little bristled.
At her not being able to laugh at that joke.
Okay.
And I voted for Hillary. So can I tease women now? I mean, I wouldn't dare. If I called my daughters and made a joke, they would just, they would, see, I get my coffee. But they want coffee too.
Oh, I didn't realize.
Thank you. But I'm going to be rude and drink my coffee.
Of course.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you. Thank you.
I think that you can still tease women. I was actually just talking to Dave a little bit earlier. The night of the election, when everything was happening.
That's good coffee. And, how does it feel like?
Fucking asshole. Son of a bitch. Just doesn't surprise me at all.
Once
this
again,
is good.
The have-nots feel it every moment.
This is Pete's coffee.
For the record, it was Feldman did force me to call him sir in a several occasions, so.
Oh, that was when with Colin.
We're trying to make up stories to
for
tell Colin.
Yes, we worked together on a show, and I kept saying, what was the worst thing I asked you to tell Colin about me?
Oh God, what was it? It was some, I think it was, it had something to do with like you pooped and didn't flush.
Mm-hmm.
And then you like, or something about you like made people look at it. No, you didn't.
It's okay.
By the way, speaking of pooping and not flushing.
Thank you. Can I have some milk and sugar? Is that annoying?
Absolutely not.
Thank you so much, Alex. Anything for Colin Quinn.
Speaking of pooping and not flushing, mm-hmm. and then we'll get back to teasing women.
Okay, great.
Okay. I worked on the Bill Maher show for a very long time, and we had bungalows at CBS where the offices were, mm-hmm. and we had a unisex bathroom. It meant the guys and the girls shared a bathroom in this bungalow. And when you work for Bill Maher, every guy and girl brings their A game to work because he is, you know, kind of, I don't want to say sexual, but he's a living and breathing human being. And mm-hmm. you just want to, there were parties and you wanted to look your best.
Right? He lives life.
He lives life. And he just wants. So when you went to work, when I went to work for Bill, you know, women would wear boots and they look great. And so I, you know, I would wear my push-up bra.
Thank you
bra.
So much.
Thank you for the coffee.
Look at this. Show briz.
Thank you. I have gynecomastia, which is male breasts. And so I would wear a push-up bra to accentuate it.
Of course.
So they hired a writer who didn't flush the toilet.
Mm-hmm.
And I can talk about this now because enough time has passed. So he didn't flush the toilet. So you would, you'd be writing and you'd hear, ah!
Stop.
I'm serious. And that was me. You'd a woman
screaming.
Or a guy would yeah. walk into the bathroom.
Yes.
And there'd be, you know.
Yeah.
There'd be some James Comey that hadn't been flushed down. And so this went on for about a month. And it, the first time it was like a mistake. The second time, it's like we've got a keeper. I call them keepers.
Okay.
Guys who, because it's always a guy mm-hmm. who, you know.
It has to be, right?
Yeah. And we knew who it was and we found out who it was.
You did some research.
How'd you find out?
We did a stakeout.
Of course you did.
We did a stakeout.
The show was delayed that night.
And I thought the guy was going to kill us.
Stop.
Seriously.
Really?
I get that. Because it's such a despicable act that it's yeah. like, if you're willing to do this, what else are you willing to do?
Right.
By the way, we had the similar problem at SNL.
I know who the writer was.
Please tell me there's one writer okay, who was so, in both places.
Anyway, so I said, I've never asked for anybody. You know, I'm low man on the totem pole. But I go, this guy, you know, we know who it is. We got it. And they go, no, just let it go. But he's letting it go. And
he too was letting it go.
So here's what happened. You can't really get rid of somebody who's mentally ill because it costs $2 billion.
At least.
Because, you know, lawsuits. You have to accept his lifestyle, shall we say. And I bring this up because once it became apparent that we had to finish the season with that guy.
Yes.
The women stopped wearing makeup. They stopped. Everybody just came to work in their clothes. And I stopped shaving. And there were days where I rolled out of bed and I said, you know, I showered a month ago. There's really no need. And I, you know, I've completely forgotten about this incident until Wednesday morning, the day after Trump was elected. Mm-hmm. And I just started coming to work unshaven, baseball cap, didn't, you know, comb the plugs, mom jeans. It's like it feels like the time that guy wouldn't flush his crap down the toilet. That's what I'm getting a flashback to. Now that we've had our coffee, and I'm going to shut up.
Thank God.
It's okay to tease women.
I would say yes.
Okay.
And the reason I feel like that, Dave and I were just talking beforehand, and I forgot where I was going with this. What were we saying earlier?
I apologize. I brought up a bad story.
Okay.
We said a lot. We said a lot of things. Was it about Lacey or about something?
No, not
all right, let me challenge you guys. I'll get you revved up. I'm going to say
okay. Okay. I like space in what I was going to say.
Get over Trump. You guys, you know what? You're not – you, the two of you guys, let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. You're miserable people.
That's accurate.
You're in bad relationships. You're unhappy. You can't stand yourself. So what you're doing is you're blaming an election. You need an excuse for your misery. So you're just saying, oh, Donald Trump won. That's why I'm unhappy. It's going to have no effect on you. Life goes on. The earth is still spinning around the sun. Unarmed black men are still getting shot by policemen. The polar ice caps are still melting. It's all stop. The world goes on. You're looking for a reason to be upset. You're miserable human beings, and you're just saying, oh, that's why I'm miserable. Donald Trump is president.
I feel like that the reason any of that is untrue is that you and I was telling Dave this earlier, is that we get to sit here and be on a stupid podcast and bitch about the election. We should be so fucking fortunate. Other people are not so much. And I think that's...
They're overreacting. This
is, oh, I hate you so much.
Seriously. Dave, come on.
You know, one thing I really didn't see coming was I thought I might hear some stories about, you know, people getting harassed in the street or having things thrown at them. What I didn't expect was that how many of those were, like, people I knew. Like, it wasn't just,
yes,
like,
so
a
close.
Few news stories
Absolutely.
About it. It was...
You don't know anybody who's
know.
You're in a bubble. And,
yeah,
and, you
I had a friend of mine in Florida.
Dave told me he's going to kill somebody today, and I think it's you, Feldman.
You're isolating. There are 350 million Americans.
Yeah,
I can go. I can find, if I look hard enough, I can find a person with a Hillary for President bumper sticker getting something thrown at them. If you look hard enough, you can find the bad in this country. But you're just isolating stuff. We're perfectly safe,
and
the stock market's up.
For now.
For this instance.
The stock market's up because people saw it going down as an opportunity to buy when things were low, because people who have trust in him are starting to buy. But when his...
You know somebody who got assaulted.
Yeah, I know a few people. I know
I
one person
well.
who got called a Hillary fag in the street because he is a bit of an effeminate gay person, and this is in Florida. And had was sort of threatened. There's also someone.
Was he beaten up?
No, not this person. I know someone else.
So who got
in California?
Beaten up?
Who in Santa Monica got a? It's a famous story, but it is someone who is actually a friend of a friend who got the bottle thrown at them. Had to go to the emergency room.
It was Reginald Denny. The guy is the most unlucky human being.
No, I think
oh
this is sort of just a victory lap of people of just how many stories about, you know, how many Muslim women are getting like choked with their hijabs, or how many people. And what I found funny about it is the stories seem very specifically about Muslim women and gay men. I don't see a lot of black men getting yelled at in the street. I don't see a lot. I see a lot of people who they know can't fight back.
Well, I think first of all, you got to watch that. Think about what you just said, young man.
I don't see. Well, because I think they're afraid of black men.
They are afraid of black men.
I don't see any men, but I didn't say white
but that,
men
but,
because
but
white
you know
men
what
are
that
presumed
does,
to be.
But you know what that does to black fans. Men when you say something like that?
What?
Black men are scared.
They should be.
I love watching two white men discuss how black men feel.
We're going to get to women in a second.
This is my favorite.
Let me say, I didn't mean black men in the terms of like that they're stronger than other men. I meant in the sense that a Trump supporter sees a white man and does not assume he's a Hillary supporter. He sees a black man, he does assume he's a Hillary supporter. So they're saying people like
Muslim
women.
Didn't a black man get cold cocked at a Trump rally?
That was both. Special effects.
Well, yes, in both ways. That went both ways. There was an old white man who attacked a black man at a rally, and then another occasion there was a black Trump supporter who punched a white man for nonviolently protesting at a rally. So
right.
I don't know if you were which one you were referring to, but yes, a black kid for giving a middle finger was punched in the face. Yeah.
Okay. And do women now? I don't think women have anything to be afraid of in this country. Right? You can walk the streets.
I can, sure, absolutely, but I'm an asshole.
Women just have nothing to worry about, right?
I think to be fair, I supported Hillary. I voted for Bernie. I supported Hillary. I was shocked once Pennsylvania went to Trump. I took some NyQuil and I was like, I'm out. I'm not going to watch the acceptance speech. I can't stomach it. Woke up the next morning pretty much nauseous, and then I went and I actually watched the concession speech with Colin, and afterwards he starts talking, and I just burst into tears. And I couldn't even sort of compute it at all of just like, why do I feel so upset and personally sort of wronged in a weird way? And I think a part of that is my sort of like white lady entitlement, which everyone likes to talk about right now, is millennials and their entitlement, and that we're whining like babies and that we're not accepting the, we're not accepting everything. But yeah, I feel like, I feel women, there is a new air of confidence.
Among sure. whom?
I would say
women.
Among not no, not among women.
Oh, I sensed. Okay, go ahead.
I think that there's a new air of confidence in the air of people, of catcallers, of people who harass women, of just like yes, thank
the
you.
Deplorables.
The deplorables
feel like they've
that there
validated.
Is just sort of this new air of confidence of just like, yeah, you're damn fucking right. We can do whatever we want to women.
Okay, and let me ask you about that because I'm in a bubble.
As am I, so I don't know how much help I'll be.
And so I only see what's in front of my nose. Mm-hmm. And I have women in my life mm-hmm. who have changed. And I don't know if it's because of aging or, you know, but I did, I've said on the show over and over again that everything changed after the last midterms. Women woke up. Or I woke up. I don't know what happened, but it seems to me as a white male who uh-huh. needs to watch himself that women in the past 2 or 3 years mm-hmm. have turned on David Feldman. No, that women, there's something, a light went on, in the especially in the past 3 years. Is that a fair statement that
the women have turned on you?
No, that women are now, and it's been in the past 3 years,
uh-huh.
that women are really not taking it anymore.
Yes, I think that would be accurate. I think that,
why is that? I think I know why.
I think that women in general are just becoming a little more aware of where they're being short, where they're being cut off, or what things are not allowed to say, or what things men are allowed to say. And I think it goes back to so simply, even just like I was recently at dinner with some people who were probably in their like 60s or 70s, and the man kept cutting off his wife while she was
Dave,
talking.
Is she right? No, I'm kidding.
No, but I will say, I think it's like one of those things where like when I'm arguing with a guy or when I'm talking to a guy and they cut me off mid-sentence, but not even rudely, just talking, it's like, wait, like shut the fuck up. Like I was in the middle of a sentence.
Uh-huh.
And I think that women are becoming more of like noticing that they're getting cut off or noticing that they're getting, I think they're just starting to notice because somebody is pointing it out to them and being like, you understand that that's not fair, correct? And I think, right. Go ahead, sorry.
No, let her finish. Just suffer through it, Dave.
I said nothing.
If I can suffer through her.
I said nothing.
Suffer through it.
Just give the veneer that you're listening.
But I will also say, I did recently go to an event, which was a panel for comedians, like women in film and television for comedians. It was part of the comedy festival. And it was a great panel of people. And I was stunned the questions that these women were asking these women who were on the panel. And I think, and I probably shouldn't say this, but I think that a lot of the reason that women are held back is because of women. I think that we attack each other way more than men attack us.
Is that a... I'm really treading in dangerous territory.
There's I know. I felt gross saying that, so.
Is that the same thing that they say about the African-American community?
I think it used to be.
But I mean, black-on-black violence. And what I'm saying is that women turn on each other. African-Americans have been accused of turning on each other. Jews turn on each other.
Yeah, but that's different.
Rats, when they're not fed properly,
we'll eat each other. Yeah,
and as you and I both know, Dave, Jews and rats, we've seen enough.
It's
I'm a Jew,
but you're by choice.
Yeah, that's true. I'm a Jew by choice.
Which Jesus. We'll get to, that's, I'll get to that.
That's a whole different
Can you
topic.
Imagine choosing to be
no,
Jewish?
No, I could not. I could not imagine
Why would you have
thing.
Chosen? I mean, we're the chosen people.
I chose myself.
You don't choose to be Jewish. You actually converted, right?
Yeah, I did. Well, I mean, my parents converted when I was five, so I converted with them, obviously.
Why would anybody?
I never understood conversion in general of any religion, personally, because I guess because to me, religion only makes sense if it was something that you were raised on. It's the only time any religion ever made sense to me is if you learned it when you were a baby. But then for an adult to then say, no, this religion's the right one, that to me, not the, you know, right or wrong, always seemed so weird to me because it was like, I can't imagine an adult looking at any religion and saying, this one, this is the correct one.
Well, anyway, let's get off religion and get back to women. So... You were surprised by the questions that women asked. Do you think it was maybe because they're so on the outside that they don't – they've been kept so afar from the inner circle that they're just – they don't know?
Well, I will say I think one of the ones that really was – one of the panelists has a bunch – has – more than a couple of kids, and she's also a showrunner, a director, a writer, a producer, and
good for her.
She's amazing.
Oh, that's great.
And one of the things I'm gonna fucking kill him. One of the things that
can
she,
I still do that?
Can you still do that? Yeah, not to me. You can't. but one of the things is, I think that more than three audience members asked her, like, "How do you do it?" Just like, how do you do it? Like, I mean, and one literally asked her, how do you stay so thin?
I was just going to ask that question. I swear to God.
And I,
how thin was she?
Yes.
No, no, I, because I would think that if you're not getting any sleep, you just eat to stay. I mean, that's the.
I was so mad. I like literally, I probably groaned loud enough for the entire fucking room to hear, but it was.
You were mad that she was so thin.
Yeah, I'm so fucking pissed. No, but it was that she that really like that is your question. We have 20 minutes, and you're asking her how she stays so thin after kids.
And how does she stay so thin?
She elegantly answered the question and then deferred it to her own work. But it was but things like that. It's like you want people to stop talking about how you're a woman. You want people to stop talking. Like so, then ask her a professional question. Like what's wrong with
you? I'm going to ask you some questions.
Great.
Okay. One of my daughters refuses to answer them.
When it refuses to answer them?
These questions. And I,
because you're not speaking.
And
because they haven't spoken in a year.
I've been accused of being a sociopath because
no.
I often ask my shrink, who I'm in constant contact with, how am I supposed to feel about this?
Okay.
Like, I'm not a normal human being. So what does a normal human being feel when treated this way? And then my shrink says, well, you have the right to be angry. So I need instructions on how to feel because I'm basically dead inside. That's why I'm a pretty good stand-up comic because I'm dead inside. I feel nothing inside. Okay. I'm a very simple human being. I just want to have sex. I want to eat. I want to read, see a movie, and have my insides function properly when it comes to my morning
rituals.
If that's why I'm a vegetarian. That's all I want. I want love, sex, food, a healthy bowel movement.
And a movie every now and again.
A movie, some good TV, a job, some money, some shelter.
Wow.
And a little boy who will service me sexually. Wow. That's all I want. I need – and then the rest of life is I just don't know how to behave. I go, well, how do you act in the – so – and I said to one of my daughters, tell me how to treat women properly. Like, what do you want? And she goes, well, if you don't know, I just tell me and I'll do it. I'm a dog. Give me a biscuit.
Okay.
Okay. So.
Okay, here we go.
Asking a woman to put a gun in my mouth in order to heighten my orgasm.
Yes.
Is that good or bad? No. Okay.
yikes. I'd happily put a gun in your mouth.
Tell me how
it's
to.
It's the right direction.
If you tell me that you want to be called an African-American, I'll call you an African-American.
Okay.
Tell me what you want.
What I want?
Yeah.
I would appreciate not it being brought to my attention every 20 minutes what my gender is and how I should feel about that.
Okay.
I think I find
I'm writing that down.
I find, and I'm not, to be fair, this is for me specifically, I think that, I think
don't
there's
acknowledge
a,
you're a woman. I'm serious, I'm writing that down.
I think there's a lot of people out there who are very, you know, future is female, which I agree with them, and I'm all about that, and I will be doing the Million Woman March come January 21st, I will be there.
There's a Million Woman March?
Yes.
Oh, good. Somebody can clean up after the inauguration.
Exactly. Isn't that wonderful?
Now, is that a bad joke?
No, I don't think that's bad. But then again, because I know you're a sociopath.
It's a bad joke. It's an easy joke.
Well, it's a lazy joke.
It's a lazy joke, exactly.
Yes. I think it's a comment on your intellect more than my.
Okay. So when a woman walks into a room, don't stand up.
No.
Because I have an erection. Don't stand up. Don't acknowledge that it's a woman.
I wouldn't. I mean, why would you stand up when I walk in the room anyways?
Because that's how I was raised.
Okay. I think that you should still hold open doors. I think that's a good thing.
Because they're heavy.
And you can check out her ass as she's walking. I'm sorry.
That is.
I'm so sorry.
I mean, that is the big secret about opening doors thing. To be honest, that is like, as a child, before you internalize it, you're like, wait, if I do this, I get like it, and it's like it's almost like a deal we make. Like,
yes.
We'll open doors for you
if we can.
It's not the most respectable thing, but like, just an example of what you're saying, like, don't acknowledge you're a woman. That as a guy, like, something that you just had to learn that I didn't know was something that was offensive
it's not offensive. And to be fair, I'm sure there's women out there who would like to be who want to, you know, walk around and, you know, like, I don't know. I mean, I don't.
Can I tell you? I've gotten into trouble.
Shocking.
Shocking women with a cattle prod, just to make them.
Yeah, that sounds accurate.
No, can you tell a woman she's beautiful?
Sure, why not?
Can you tell a woman she's sexy?
If she's single and you're single and it's the right context, sure.
In an office situation,
no.
Exactly.
Yes.
I'm going to be really naive here. That still goes on, right?
Sure.
Guys flirt in an office, right?
Wait, I will tell you a story really quick about.
Well, how was I? Now, was I. Honestly, I treated you.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Right.
I thought we had a nice time.
And I never said anything.
No.
Right.
No. I will say, I think that.
Did I ever even slightly say anything?
No, you did not.
Inappropriate.
No.
That's right. You know why?
Why?
Because I hate women.
Accurate.
And I don't want them to win.
Obviously.
Especially in court.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I kind of made a vow to myself when I started working. I will not lose a sexual harassment case. I will treat women in the office like robots.
And I will win every sexual harassment case.
I will not be accused of sexual harassment. They will not. I'm going to treat them like robots. And then I just start treating everybody like robots, and it makes for a happier work environment. Everybody's
right.
There to make money and go home.
Right. Of course.
That's it.
Yes.
And you know what? I've been in situations where men have harassed me in the office. They have it out for me, and for some reason, and I think, oh, I get it. It's happened enough to me where I go, oh, I get it. I'm like a beautiful woman in the 50s.
I've always thought of you as a beautiful woman.
Not
in
my 50s, but in the 50s.
Yeah.
I'm a beautiful woman, and this guy will not leave me alone.
Right.
And it's scary.
It is scary. Yes. I will say I had one. We have a mutual colleague of ours, and this is obviously very unintentional. We were both walking out of the building one night, just talking randomly, and we're leaving. And I realized that as we have gone down in the elevator and walked outside, he somehow unbuckled his pants and undone his top button. And that was all he did. But then he walked away and went home, and I was just like, what the fuck just happened? It was very bizarre.
I cannot wait to see if I'm right about who I'm guessing this was.
Yeah, I'll be interested to see what you say later. And it wasn't, I never felt like threatened or anything, but it was just one of those things where I was like, what just happened?
Okay, if I said to you, if we were walking out, mm-hmm. now we're out of the building.
We're out of the building.
Can I walk you to the subway? Mm-hmm. Or can I walk you home? It's late. Mm-hmm. I'm worried that for your safety.
That's fine.
I'm worried for your safety because I'm a...
You're a ghost. How can
I is that so? Is it okay? When do I get to acknowledge that I'm physically and mentally stronger than you? Without it being kind of...
That it's to be discussed whether you're physically or mentally stronger than me.
And in other words, what about ordering when we go... Hey, you have a question?
No, keep going.
You have a... We have,
just keep... Finish your thought. Behind.
Oh, great. We got breaking news that Trump says he wants to spend weekends in his penthouse in Trump Tower.
Stop.
I'm sure that won't affect New York
City. Oh, wild presence.
That's great.
Oh, good.
That will be known as Concentration Camp David.
Jesus.
That doesn't work. That joke does not track because...
Camp David isn't like... No one knows.
Well, no. I'm saying Concentration Camp David. That wouldn't be his concentration camp.
Right. Hitler didn't live in
right. It'll be the Wolf's
in
Lair.
In Auschwitz, yeah.
So hang on. Hitler didn't live in Auschwitz? There's a Wolf's Lair joke. The Berchtesgaden was where he hung out.
Most of my World War II info comes from playing Castle Wolfenstein, so I don't know the names of the actual people or places.
Isn't there a wolf? Like, there's a joke. If you go after women, what do you call something?
The predator.
Okay.
Anywho.
So when I go out to dinner with a woman, ordering for her.
Oh my God! Infuriating.
The woman will have. All right. What about
if and I will say when I used to be a server and a bartender, and the man would order for the woman, it made me more angry at the woman.
That doesn't happen.
Yes, it does.
No, it doesn't.
It fucking does.
No, it doesn't.
I will see right here. I'm telling you a fucking fact, and you're like, it didn't happen.
I refuse to accept that.
No, it happens.
That men order for women.
Yes. 100%.
Older men more, I would imagine.
You would be shocked. And people think it's this, people think it's like this courtesy thing or whatever. But for me, and I, to be fair, the same goes for like little kids. I cannot stand it when the mom orders for little kids.
Okay, hang on for 1 second. Where did you wait tables?
Nizza. It's a restaurant on 9th Avenue between 44th and 45th.
And what kind of food do they serve?
I'm assuming.
Italian, Northern Italian.
I was going to say, it just sounds like an Italian place you buy meat.
Okay, I learned something.
Well,
not
Nizza
called,
is Nice.
It's Italian, not Italian.
Jesus Christ. I'm leaving.
I'm learning. Okay. All right. And so you had dates, you know, couples.
Yes.
And, and was he ordering, was he choosing for her?
That's unclear. I don't know if he was choosing for her or not, but he was ordering for her for sure.
Marley Maitland's husband always orders for her.
Good for Marley.
I bet that's not even true. I bet she says it, or at least points.
She's Jewish, by the way.
Oh, wow.
How do you wine with your hands? That's what I always want to know. But anyway.
Seems like a smooth transition to be Jewish and speak in sign language.
Fair.
I wish my mother spoke in sign language. So the guy's... That happens.
Yes.
If you're a sentient female, shouldn't you hate men?
Shouldn't I hate men?
Yeah. Why?
That comment alone is annoying.
Okay.
Because I don't want to.
I hate men.
You hate men?
Yeah.
That's surprising.
I do.
Elaborate.
Like you hate traffic, but you're still going to use the roads.
I think. As long as I can keep my patriarchy,
right? Of course.
As long as I have, as long as it's
doesn't
no
affect you.
I think we have to surrender to women. As long as I can somehow pull a Hail Mary and become a one percenter,
right?
Then I'm all for
the demise of white men everywhere.
Yes.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I think the way we conduct ourselves is if this continues, we're doomed. Right. Or the planet is over.
I think one of men's greatest weaknesses is that they have a hard time admitting if they're doing something wrong because they have too much pride or ego.
No, that's women.
Women
can't admit they're wrong.
Women can admit they're wrong, but they won't, so they'll manipulate the situation so you think that you're wrong.
Well, go over this again, please. Go over this again.
I think that even if a woman, even if I'm in the middle of an argument and I'm like, I'm wrong, I'm in the wrong here, it is extremely hard for me to admit that I'm wrong, but so it's easier for me to manipulate the conversation so that I can make them feel like they're wrong.
What about when you're arguing with another woman? This is great.
That's an interesting question.
What is it? So, okay. When you get men alone in a room, they will say, why can't women admit they're wrong?
Okay.
Right? You've heard that, right?
Sure.
Is that a fair statement?
Yeah.
That women cannot admit they're wrong.
That it's something we say, sure.
I do know women personally who cannot admit they're wrong.
Right.
Yes.
Men
okay.
too.
Yeah, absolutely. But in relationships, so is it, we're making a sweeping generalization, but I think most men quietly will say she can't admit she's wrong. So what, when women get alone in a room, what do they all say about men? When you know, if there's anything.
I would think there's an element of pride that certain men have that won't admit that they are wrong either. And I think that's something that women talk about.
Okay, and so you said, by the way, we're talking with Kristen Buckels. She's a woman, and it's she's interesting. And how long have you been a woman?
Been a woman for 28 years now.
And you speak for all women.
Not at all. Probably just me. I'm probably already pissed off many people.
And asking you these questions is annoying, isn't it?
No, not really. It's fine.
People
have to learn. Yeah, I think it's more annoying when people assume how to treat women or how to talk or what to say. I think that I don't know. I feel like I'm wrong a lot of the time because I get frustrated. Just like, you know, if there's just like one more like women's movement where we all just like get up and talk about we're women, I'll blow my head off. It gets very exhausting.
Yeah. A lot of women don't like to do my show. And I love having women on the show because I like asking them questions. But then people complain, like Colleen Wertman does the show, and then people complain that I ask her questions as though she speaks for all women. But I'm just kind of interested in women because I was married for 30 years and now I'm getting a divorce. I'm almost done. And I never really talked to women. You know, I was in love with one woman. I didn't flirt. I didn't cheat. I just kind of, you know, went home and read. And so now my daughters are of age and they're thinking far differently than women were when I was looking for women. So I just find it, you know, I'm a dinosaur trying to understand this stuff. So I apologize. Well, I'm sure you didn't come on this show to answer these questions.
I expected nothing less.
No, I think it's unfair to you, actually.
I apologize. No, I don't care. I honestly feel like when I answer these questions and I hear the things coming out of my mouth, I'm like, oh, I'm kind of a shitty person.
No. And you specifically said that you don't want to be acknowledged as a woman. So let me move on.
Okay.
And I apologize.
Now that we're all depressed.
No, I apologize. But here's the problem that my personal problem, and then we'll change the subject and we'll talk about Trump. I gave an interview for a book called The Satiristas. This was like 6 years ago. And I said, I'm sick of hearing identity politics and identity comedy. Just be funny.
Okay.
And I was wrong for saying that. because I didn't understand what it meant to be black in this country. Mm-hmm. I don't understand what it means to be gay in this country. I don't understand what it means to be a woman in this country. I know what it's like to be a Jew. But, you know, if you, it's not the same thing. You can change your name. So I apologize, but I do think that people like me need to understand what it's like to be a gay person in America. Dave Sirus, what is it like?
Oh, I knew that was coming. Well, you know, all I can say is that, like, you know, as I'm in the same boat as you. I'm a straight white Jew. So I don't, yeah, it's not Warsaw in the 30s. I don't know what it's like to be a heavily discriminated minority in the country I live in.
All we know is what it's like to perpetuate the discrimination.
Yes. Well, I mean, I
did you have any feelings of relief when Trump won?
Oh, God, no. I was nothing but dread.
But as a white male.
The only relief I had was in the just desire to see his fans have to actually own what they've been doing. The only relief I had was the idea that now you get to see how deeply you've been conned and how much more complicated the world you live in is than you would like to believe. Yeah. That was the only solace.
Because and do you think they're capable of realizing they've
no,
been conned?
No, absolutely not.
A minority of them are.
No.
I would say a minority.
Well, but the ones who voted for Obama and voted for Trump,
those are the worst people because they don't acknowledge that they how much of a fuck you they gave Obama by voting for someone endorsed by the only newspaper he was endorsed by was the Klan's. Like I think
there were other paper, the Santa Barbara paper.
Oh, did he eventually get other endorsements? Yeah. Okay. Well, I think that was the only thing I wanted them to, because I knew that if they lost, they would for the rest of their lives say, oh, we almost did it. We almost fixed it. Oh, us poor. And how like we see how only being a victim galvanizes people in this country. Only being on the wrong side of something gets anyone to even pay attention. That like liberals, it took Bush for them to even wake up and try to do something. Just like Obama, the people who hate him, even though it's for much less rational reasons, that's the power that they had. And now that they're in charge, now they suddenly are in a position, well, yeah, okay, let's see how great these ideas were that you actually believed he meant. And though I'm not that optimistic about them being honest about that, it is something I want to see.
Okay, how upset are you that Trump won? Seriously.
I really feel I'm at a 10.
Out of what?
10. I feel I don't have anything to compare this to that's outside of a personal tragedy of when I felt like this.
9/11?
How old are you in 9/11?
I was an adult.
You were an adult?
Yeah, I was
an adult. How old are you?
I'm 38.
We know my age, so.
How much do you weigh?
I'm 38.
Yeah, how much do you weigh?
About 160.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Something like that.
How big's your penis?
Yeah, answer that.
Is it thick?
I'd answer, but I know I'm going to look like an asshole if I do.
Okay. Is it thick? Will I
I'm
going to
leave
it?
The room and let you boys have this minute.
I know I'm not supposed to answer these all questions, right, honestly, and I so want to. I was very upset. 9/11 upset me. 9/11 was very upsetting to me. But
because
the thing
pulled your back dancing.
I mean, let me say, I was in 9/11. I was in Boston during 9/11.
That's what you're telling the authorities.
Yes, I was at a frat. I just want to say that on record that I was in Boston, and I had
welcoming flights in from Maine, I believe.
yes.
Jesus Christ.
Now, when it happened, I was very upset, and I was mostly upset.
What happened?
On 9/11.
You were upset.
I was very upset because I first just upset for like the loss of life and for my dread of what this was going to mean. But I think the difference was on 9/11, it was, oh, this is so horrible, but a sense of the worst has already happened and now we have to start building towards it. Whereas with Trump, it's here it comes. It's not as upsetting.
Impending doom.
It's not as upsetting on a visceral level, but it's more upsetting because there's so much more uncertainty.
What do you think is the worst that's going to happen?
He will instigate a nuclear war.
Okay. Besides that.
I think we're I think we are in a rocket space.
Okay, hang on. Do you realize
I'm not being I'm
in the business. let me tell you something about this. I have a responsibility to my listeners to anesthetize them into compliance.
Yes.
So when you talk this way, you're jeopardizing my gig here on the David Feldman Show, which is to make people compliant.
I think he'll instigate a full-scale grant.
Now, aren't you being – come on now. Aren't you just being Mr.
–
He said it. He said he would do it. He said.
So how bad are nuclear weapons? Seriously.
They're bad because
– don't you think if we had
– I think we're about to break a seal that we weren't ever supposed to break.
We already dropped two.
Yeah, but it's been a we managed to
What about above ground testing of nuclear weapons that didn't wipe out the planet?
No, that was just testing. That's like going to a gun range.
I mean, it's not like you can't explode a nuclear bomb and like one bomb's going to go off and the whole world comes to an end.
Eh. Our only hope was that it wipes out Feldman.
Yeah, but
no, seriously. I mean, you know.
I think that we're talking about
Chernobyl. Was it? I'm being serious.
Yeah, Chernobyl was a terrible,
and it still
but
is.
But it didn't ruin the world.
I mean, it's still in some breast milk in Europe. Mm-hmm. I'm being I'm being jokingly difficult to. I agree with you.
I think he's a mentally ill person who.
But don't you think we have generals? Don't you think we have good people who will, you know, violate? One of the things we learned, I remember during the Oliver North hearings, I was taught that after the Nuremberg trials, we instituted laws in the Army that you cannot follow an order if it's illegal. Don't you think we have people in the military who won't follow his orders because they're wrong?
That's not exactly a firewall I'm willing to stake my life on. I think that we have a
I agree with you on the nuclear power, nuclear energy, nuclear holocaust.
Okay, environmentally, he could be the catalyst of the end of the world. Environmentally, by suspending all environmental protection, by installing conspiracy theorists into the EPA who believe things that are provably
false. Is
Ebel
one of those guys?
Yeah. I think that.
So where does it? So should the Democrats? Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. I just think that there are several different outs here for the end of the world.
What about the Justice Department?
Oh, I don't know how that's going to pan out. How much he's going to get of what he wants. I know he wants the way he talks about black neighborhoods sounds like someone. It sounds like an emperor describing a rebel base that they need to wipe out.
It's like you describing women, Feldman, if that makes sense.
Do you think so in other words, what he's going to do is he's going to put people in charge who aren't going to enforce the laws that are on the books. So that if you're a black person, the cops now can do whatever they want without a consent decree. The local police officers will no longer have to worry about a consent decree from the Justice Department.
I think it encourages people who see the current problems between the police and black communities as an opportunity to – this is simple. They want to treat this like a military operation and treat black citizens of the United States as like a foreign body that needs to be crushed. Mm-hmm. I do think that is the overall undertone of the kind of criminal justice system he wants to have, because he never, ever even hinted at caring about what the underlying problems that we're creating this were. He simply wants to shut it down.
Kristen Buckels. You talk about, you know, we talked about women on women. What? Women on women at the... thing.
Yeah.
Jew on Jew, black on black.
Right.
Democrat on Democrat.
Oh, boy.
If Chuck Schumer gives any quarter to Trump on day one, off with his head, right?
Off with his head.
Who's more to blame for this guy Ebel becoming head of the Environmental Protection Agency or Giuliani or Chris Christie becoming AG, Attorney General, Trump,
oh my God,
or
so
Chuck Schumer? Who's more to blame?
I'd say Chuck Schumer.
Why?
Because he knows better.
And he has a responsibility to do what?
To handle this.
To block.
Yes.
To fight.
Yes.
And if he's not up for the job?
Off with his head.
Off with his head.
You know, the thing that upsets me the most about this is that what we've seen is the death of moderation. It seems like it is going to be now impossible for a moderate to ever run this country.
Who cares? We don't need a moderate. Elizabeth Warren is a moderate. Bernie Sanders is a moderate. Anybody with an education who thinks rationally would look at Bernie Sanders and say, oh, he's thinking moderately. He's a socialist. Anybody who says, which Bernie Sanders has said, is that Wall Street, their whole entire business model is fraud, that is a moderate, rational assessment. There is a, you know, we had Greg Proops on earlier, mm-hmm. and we're talking about the Nazis. And, you know, there was a fever that swept Europe in the 30s, mm-hmm. or Germany, anti-Semitism, racism, you know, eugenics, which started in America. There's a fever now that's sweeping the world. Same things, you know, racism. But there's also an intellectual fever of supply-side economics, austerity. It's a fever that swept Europe after the Great Recession, austerity. It's a fever that has swept the United States, Paul Ryan and the Republicans. This austerity fever, it's as vile and disgusting and wrong as anti-Semitism and racism and sexism. This austerity fever of lower taxes, strangle the government. That's a fever based, rooted in stupidity, false science.
In emotional fear.
Yes.
Yeah. And the same thing. And, you know, climate deniers. There's a fever of stupidity.
Yes.
Anti-intellectualism mm-hmm. that is sweeping the world.
Mm-hmm. It's the desire to want to make intelligence an artificial construct. It's people who want to be able to say that intelligence was never a real thing. It was always something that the elites were telling us was real.
Right.
I do believe that. It.
So when they go low, we go high? I don't know.
It's not going to. It doesn't work.
So, you know, there comes a time when the Democrats, we don't need Chuck Schumer.
No.
You need Elizabeth Warren.
But it scares me about the idea that we become a country that is purely a pendulum, that we just swing further,
what pendulum?
Further and harder each direction.
It's not going in each direction.
Well, Trump, I mean, look.
But where's it going to the left? You know, I love Barack Obama, but he's a
moderate.
He's a corporatist.
He's a moderate. He's extremely moderate, but the problem
is he's not a moderate. He's a corporatist. Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren are moderates.
I mean, I see Hillary Clinton as what I would call a moderate Democrat, and I know that even though moderate Democrat is what a moderate Republican was 20 years ago, I think that there's a lot going on here in terms of like people, they're looking at their politics as sport. And that creates an impossibility of trying to have stability. People thought of Obama as not moderate because he's black, not because of his policies, because the Republican Party has tried to push the middle artificially further and further right until CNN is looked at as left wing, which is insane when you look at what they're actually reporting and saying.
That's fair.
Okay. So let me tell you what to do. And then you tell people what to do. And then you tell people what to do.
Okay.
Subscribe to the New York Times. I know people hate the New York Times. They hate the New York Times because they don't know how to read the New York Times. Subscribe to the Washington Post. Even though it's owned by Jeff Bezos now, Washington Post is a great newspaper. Subscribe to The Economist. Subscribe to The Nation magazine. Read the Daily Kos. Subscribe to Mother Jones Magazine. Go to their website. Read the New Yorker. Maybe not Shouts and Murmur, but that's never been funny. But read the New Yorker, read the Economist, support real journalism, and practice what Walter Cronkite called internet literacy. Don't get your news from Facebook.
Don't believe things because they make you feel good.
Yes.
Read the New York Times. If the New York Times disappears, this country disappears. Read the editorials in the New York Times. Read the Washington Post. Read the LA Times. Watch CBS News. Listen to Amy Goodman. If you cannot get Democracy Now! On your Pacifica station, go to democracynow.org, read her. And Ralph Nader.
And Ralph Nader.
Give to Planned Parenthood.
Mike Pence's name, which you can do.
Oh, really?
Yes, you can.
Okay. Give to the ACLU. Give to the Southern Poverty Law Center. They won't leave you alone. And ignore Ann Coulter. When people say something about Ann Coulter, say, I thought she passed away.
I thought she died.
I thought she died. And by the way, that roast really...
God, that was the best.
Oh, yeah, and it really helped the... It really talked people out of voting for Trump. If you're...
I'm still proud of it.
Well, you know, that's the other thing.
Still proud of our work.
That's the other thing with the comedy. It's good to laugh. We need to laugh. Get your news from somebody other than Bill Maher, Samantha Bee, John Oliver, and Stephen Colbert. They're great. They're important shows. Get your news from news sources. Stop laughing.
Stop laughing about it.
I absolutely stand by my KKK comparison with Ann Coulter that I wrote for that roast. I think.
Which one was yours?
Last year Martha Stewart we had Martha Stewart sell sheets. Now we have Ann Coulter who cuts eye holes in them.
Oh fuck yeah!
All right, and that's a great joke, and it's a narcotic. It's an opiate. Makes us feel good. If you're a lawyer and you're unhappy, stop taking classes at UCB. Don't call me. Don't call me. Don't contact me through my website and say I'm a miserable lawyer. I hate my job. Help me become a comedian. I'm not interested in helping you. You need to go work for the ACLU. We need lawyers in this country to grind the Republican Party to a halt. Stop. If you're a young person and you want to be a comedian and a comedy writer, if you really have to do it, like Dana Carvey said about comedy, it's only good if it's the only thing you can do. If you can do other things, it's time to put that away and go do something important. That's what I'm telling you. And we need to laugh. It feels good. But we need fewer childish things in our life, like video games and binge watching The Good Wife. Stop binge watching television.
Dave, this is directly at you.
I have seen so many of my generation succumb to Netflix.
Have you seen Game of Thrones?
You know, it's read.
It's actually better than the books.
Is it?
I've read
the books.
It's
so good.
You know, and I know Comic-Con. I know graphic. You know, okay. Go ahead. What do people need to do?
I just think I would have to agree with. I would say just in the past, and guiltily, I would say I would just in the past like 2 years have I really become diligent about reading the news. I remember growing up, and my dad is an attorney, and he
is he looking for a career in stand-up? Because I can tutor him for.
My dad is actually a spitting, more handsome image of Wolf Blitzer. But
somebody's more attractive than Wolf.
It's true. But no, I mean, I definitely recall growing up, my dad would have, you know, NPR going every morning, and that's sort of what I would listen to going to school. And I think just in the past few years, I've become much more diligent.
Yeah, we should listen to Amy Goodman instead of NPR.
Amy Goodman instead of NPR?
Yeah, Democracy Now.
Okay. I would say I do. I listen to NPR quite a bit, so yeah, I will start listening to Amy Goodman.
You know, NPR and the PBS is a disgrace. It's just a bunch of overpaid, latte-sipping white people who manufacture consent as...
Even Terry Gross?
Let me ask you a question. Go ahead. Okay. What else should people do?
I think couch politics is something that my generation is extremely a big fan of, and I am guilty of it as well. I was just telling Sirus earlier how I've had to like ban myself from Facebook a little bit. I think stop posting every article that you find fascinating and just start reading them and start doing actionable things with those. I think there's lots of things that you can do. You can volunteer at all these other places and causes that you care about. And I think, too, the young people who are comedians and who are writers use that and use that platform as a place where you can do some good.
Comedy?
Yes.
Okay. You actually think comedy does anything good other than anesthetize? I mean, I think comedy is as good as morphine.
Yeah.
I mean, we need morphine to kill pain.
But you don't
change the world on morphine.
No. I don't think you change the world. I think that just like my partner Lacey and I, we're doing shows next year, which we are going to be raising money for these different...
Remember we were just talking about that. Raising money.
Raising money for these different organizations.
I mean, you have a benefit. But also, you need to make money.
Right.
How do people support you?
If anybody would like to write me a check for my rent, that would be lovely.
Okay.
I don't want to say starving artist because I think that is the most annoying term in the whole world. But I think that, yeah, I mean, I really do. I sort of get my work where I can get it, and I try to do a bunch of writing. But for the most part, I just get like little jobs here and there, and it's feast or famine for me. But I like what I do. And I think that we are very determined to sort of step up and make a difference and stop just making shows just about getting our work out there and more about raising money for the things that we care about.
And if you're a performer,
uh-huh.
Do you have to talk about politics?
No.
If you don't follow politics that closely, should you just entertain? Yes.
Yeah.
Right?
I think one of the most dangerous things, and I think that is that, you know, I'm going to be annoying here for a minute, but Hillary did get so many endorsements from, you know, Lena Dunham and Amy Schumer.
Go ahead.
Listen, so, and, you know, Beyonce and all these people, and before I go any further, I love Lena Dunham and I love Amy Schumer.
Go back.
I think that their endorsements might have done more harm than
Thank her. You! Thank you!
Oh my
Thank
God.
You.
Feldman
Thank
left.
Thank you so much. Oh my God. Thank you. Thank you so much. go on. Thank you.
I think that I mean, I myself, on a personal level, I definitely, I love Lena Dunham's work and I love Amy Schumer's work so much, and I definitely feel exactly the way that they do. But I think that nobody, and especially the people who wound up voting for Trump, nobody wants to be told what to do or how to think. And I think that, or what's cool, or I honestly don't know how to phrase this, but I'm probably making myself look like an idiot right now. But I think that it might have hurt her more than it helped her.
Especially Lena Dunham. There was this dance rap thing that she did,
which was almost offensive.
That was like, quite frankly, more about her getting down to her goal weight than it was about the election.
I don't ever want to talk about a girl's weight in context of her
it was not about body acceptance. It was about it was one of the most offensive things I've seen. And I can when you know Alec Baldwin, I don't need him on my side mm-hmm. when he's not paying taxes.
Right.
I think there's a thank you for saying this, because there is this idea that if Jay-Z, and I know it's a character, but he uses language that, it's in Ted Nugent territory. Mm-hmm. When the politicians who come hat in hand to Hollywood, give your money, Hollywood, but you're not helping.
No.
You're turning.
You're not politicians.
And the other thing about Hollywood is there are many people in Hollywood who treat their employees like crap. They don't pay their bills. They make you wait for their money. They're abusive. But they're Democrats. I'm a liberal. Mm-hmm. And I can't help but think a lot of these people use liberalism as a means to expiate their their sins, it makes them feel good to worry about the planet when they should be worrying about how they treat the people right in front of their nose.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think a big part of why people hate celebrities, though, is naked, hypocritical jealousy. I think a lot of people hate celebrities, and they look at celebrities because they aren't, because they look at something they want to be, and they say, fuck you, you're the elite. And I think there's a lot of ego involved in why people hate
these people.
How
dare you tell me what to do?
Yeah.
You have no idea what my life is like.
Right. I think that anytime. And it happens on the left plenty. It happens on the left with rich people, and it happens on the right with famous people. They have a hatred of people simply because but it makes you an incredible hypocrite to hate someone who you would trade places with. I think that is, I see that all the time on both sides, and it makes me sick.
I definitely don't hate anyone. I just think, I mean, like I said, I love Lena Dunham and I love Amy Schumer, and I remember seeing the Instagram of Hillary and Jay-Z.
I love Amy Schumer.
I love Amy Schumer. You don't love Lena Dunham, I take it.
I don't think you write a book talking about putting pennies in your sister's vagina.
Yeah, that kind of became just sort of, I don't know how you put that, like porn of, you know, being willing to be honest about, like being willing to say embarrassing things about yourself was almost like self-embarrassment porn.
I don't think you launch a book tour by bringing performers with you and not paying them. She doesn't even know that you're supposed to pay your performers when you tour with them.
What performers?
Well, there was
Lena Dunham toured?
Yeah, there was a little thing where she didn't quite get it that...
That wasn't, yeah.
The
people
I didn't know
she's
going
to... Huh?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, there's a little thing like that. I just think, you know what? I don't think a Brian Williams' daughter should have her... derriere being eaten out on a show because Lena Dunham wants to humiliate Brian Williams' daughter.
You think that's why she did it?
Yeah, I think there's something sick about showing that.
I think it's interesting that she makes you feel like this.
Well, I think if you're Brian Williams' daughter, Edward R. Murrow's daughter knew not to get videotaped having her ass eaten out. Mm-hmm. There's just, you know, if you're gonna get work because you're Brian Williams' kid, you have a responsibility. If your father's the anchor man on the NBC News,
yeah,
you might not want to get your asshole eaten out on television.
You think she has a responsibility to maintaining some?
Other than that, or change your name.
Okay. Okay.
In other words, I say Eric Trump and Donald Trump are now the object of ridicule because mm-hmm. they weren't man enough to change their last name and make it on their own. You want the good mm-hmm. that comes with your dad's name. You're going to have to take the bad now.
Right.
Otherwise, change your name. Dave Sirus.
Yes.
You'll come back?
Of course.
You'll come back, right?
Of course.
You're not mad at me, are you?
I will someday be able...
Of course not.
I will someday have...
You definitely have to come back so I can make you mad at me. What do people need to do?
I want
to
be funny on this show someday. I want to not be just...
You know what? My listeners... Look, I had a cold that didn't go away for a month, so I didn't want to be funny because I would have started laughing and I would have sounded like a coal miner.
Yeah.
So we've been doing some serious shows... And I'm not in the mood to laugh right now.
Me neither.
If I can think of a joke, I would think of one.
What people should do now is go outside, dig a hole, field strip an AK-47 and rebuild an old Jeep engine with parts that they're going to find in dumpsters, because that's going to be one of the main jobs in the future. And as a Jew, I am saying, I think I can get away with saying this, when it comes to politics now, the long knives have to come out. And we need to start cleansing our party and get our house in order and make sure that the people that we really believe in are the ones that we're supporting, because this is going to be a real war. And this is, we cannot fuck around with this anymore. I think that we need to not bow down. We need to not become the Democrats of the 80s. This is too important. And Trump is going to give us opportunities to cut him down. And we need to take them. And we need to, and I know this sounds really counterproductive, we need to not forgive the people in our life that are supporting him.
I agree.
We need to make them understand what they have traded for their support of him.
I agree.
I am not going to sacrifice my core values to maintain relationships.
I agree.
And
amen, brother.
And also, never... ever introduce a female stand-up by calling her pretty. That's just...
You know that story.
What?
Is that a real story? That's something I've noticed in the last few years of that, just because we were talking about it earlier, that a perfect example of treating women, because just it's something that's been on my mind, mm-hmm. treating women like women. I did not notice until well into my adulthood. If you look at the older the movie you look at, the more women... are exclusively talked to in the context of being women. Like, look at old episodes of Star Trek. And it's like, even then, like, women are just like, it's like, how can a woman's emotions be held in check in order to do this job? Or are you sure that your tits aren't going to get in the way of being able to figure out how this equipment works? I think that there's a lot to that, and I think we need to... And also, on the other side of being a good liberal...
So you're saying that... For dinosaurs like me, my confusion and uncomfortability is something that is my problem, and I better figure it out.
I think a big part of the problem with this election is people not willing to adapt to change, mm-hmm. and I think people do need to be more willing to adapt to change, but always look at it critically, just like you look at your Facebook
Check
posts.
Your privilege, in other words.
Yeah.
Yeah, look, white privilege does exist. At the same exact time, I think that there are a lot of people who need to realize that they're being unreasonable with the amount of scoring they think they're doing by cutting down people who are on their side. I think that this shows us that liberals need to stop feeling like their job is to simply make the number of them smaller and actually look at the people who are on your side and try to make the world better and not cut them down simply because you feel like it makes you look harder core.
Okay. Let me ask you, we have to – go ahead.
No. I was just going to say that I think that one thing that makes me extremely upset with liberals or, you know, the people that I've spoken to in the past is that they – is that there is just sort of this, like, lack of passion of teaching or helping other people understand. I think that to ask you to know how to treat women in this day and age through osmosis is insane.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there is a responsibility for other – like I had something earlier this year where a kid used a word or a slur in the wrong context, and he's young and didn't understand. And a group of people, almost mob mentality, started just shutting him down and yelling at mm-hmm. him. And the kid genuinely didn't understand that what he was doing was offensive.
Can I guess?
What?
T-word?
No.
Okay.
And it was And he genuinely didn't understand what he was doing was offensive. And all of a sudden, all these people came up in arms to tell him what an idiot he was.
Right.
And I found that to be disgusting.
Right.
And I think it's our job to teach people.
Okay, so let me ask you a question, because I have a very vociferously opinionated audience, and I get angry. I get love, and I get criticism. I don't think, you know, there's that Lenny Bruce book, How to Talk to a Black Person. You know, on this show, as we move forward, and we do have to wrap it up, we're in an echo chamber, and I accept that. I've tried to have Trump supporters on the show, and I've tried to have, and people just get really pissed off. And I understand why, because you can hear them someplace else. So I get it that this show, especially in the next 2 or 3 years, is going to be an echo chamber. But it's okay to be an echo chamber, but you have to give marching orders, talking points, and instructions,
mm-hmm.
and then be funny. We're going to keep the comedy going, but it's, you know, I really need to figure out how to do this show in the next 70 days. What do I do in the next 70 days in the lead up to Trump? I don't want to sound self-important. But, you know, I got a lot of listeners.
Yeah.
And they are expecting me to do something. You complain about not being funny. You're one of the smartest people I know. I don't need to worry about you being funny.
I do, because I don't think that anything I say is worth listening to unless it's funny.
And you're one of the smartest people I know.
Thank you so much.
So I don't need to worry about you guys. There'll be a time and a place to be funny. I just need to figure out how to do this show for the next year. And I welcome your comments at davidfeldmanshow.com. I know a lot of you are angry that I did a show about cats. I stand by it. I wasn't in the mood to discuss the election.
Which is fine.
Yeah, we did a show about cats, and we ignored it.
I don't think we can just live off hate for 4 straight years of him either.
That sounds exhausting.
Yeah, I you know, there's a lot of whining going on, but you got to take action. I do a radio show with Ralph Nader, nader.org. Go listen to it if you want marching orders. So call Elizabeth Warren's office at 202-224-4543 and ask her to run for president and challenge Senator Schumer. She should be the minority leader. That's Elizabeth Warren. Read about Elizabeth Warren. Call the ACLU and give them money.
Mm-hmm.
Give money to the ACLU. 1-800-798-7092 is the number for Planned Parenthood. Even if you donate, you know, $5, it adds up. Let's plug some gigs. Dave Sirus, how do people contact you?
You know, go to the Twitter, Dave Sirus. It's Sirus spelled like virus with an S. You know, check my YouTubes if you want to see me harassing hate groups in a much different time in America where that was quaint and they were a minority. by just looking up Bridgestone anywhere, you know, like the...
Yeah, we never got to talk about that.
Yeah, who cares? And I started doing that before gay marriage was legal. At a time when it actually was slightly subversive to get in the face of an anti-gay protester and make them feel stupid. Now it feels like cheerleading. So yeah. That's why it doesn't really have the appeal that it once had to me.
Okay.
And
also, I'm busy now.
Kristen Buckels.
Yes.
How do people get in touch with you?
You can go to twobushes.com, which is my website for Between Two Bushes that I have my partnership with Lacey Jekka. We actually have a show coming up on November 26th at the Bell House at 7:30. We're going to be featuring comedians Colin Quinn, Julio Torres, Jordan Carlos, and Will Miles.
When is Greg – is that the day after Thanksgiving?
2 days after Thanksgiving.
Okay, because Greg Proops is there on Friday.
Oh, really?
Black Friday.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so we're doing a show called Dog Day After Night. All proceeds are going to be going to Badass Brooklyn Animal Rescue because we wanted to do something light and fun.
Saving the cats.
We're saving animals. We're saving mostly – I think they do mostly dogs.
Because cats are murderers.
Cats are – my cats are serial killers. There's no doubt about that.
They are.
Yeah, absolutely.
They are funny and cute, and I love them, but they – they do. They're sociopaths.
They are sociopaths, absolutely.
We are doing a benefit for the ACLU at QED Friday, November 18th. Is it November 19th or 18th? 18th. Friday, November 18th. Swipe left. The great John Fugelsang, Frank Conniff, Jeffrey Joseph, Jessica Kirsten. The show starts at 7:30. All profits go to the ACLU. Tickets are $10. Let me repeat. Swipe left with John Fugelsang, Frank Conniff, Jeffrey Joseph, Jessica Kirsten. Tickets are $10. I'll be on the show, but you should come anyway. All the profits go to the ACLU. Friday, November 18th at QED. And I want to thank the listeners, because a lot of you have been emailing me about the show. And, you know, we're going to keep doing it. And we're not going to, as Noam Chomsky said, manufacture consent here. I think somebody else coined that term, manufacturing consent, but I attribute it to Noam Chomsky. We're going to do this show, and we're going to give you information, make you laugh, and then give you marching orders. It's not good enough to sit here and make jokes and whine. You have to take action. And the first thing to do is support the people on the show, support us. And I'm going to end by telling you, first and foremost, Elizabeth Warren's phone number is 202-224-4543. Call her. Ask her to run for president and challenge Chuck Schumer for Senate Minority Leader. Give to Planned Parenthood. I hope I'm giving the right number out here. 1-800-798-7092. Maybe 7042. ACLU, go to their website. Come to our benefit from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us. Howard Leib was on our show a few years back when he was running for state senate in New York. He lost. He is also an attorney with over 25 years' experience in intellectual property law. He has represented Bobby McFerrin, Whitney Houston, the great Judy Collins, Atlantic Records, Universal Entertainment, Rhino Entertainment. He has been called America's leading children's entertainment attorney by Billboard magazine. He has taught law at New York University, the Fashion Institute of Technology, Kaplan University, and produces CDs and DVDs. He's an active member of the New York Democratic Lawyers Association, where he works to protect and expand voter rights. He is chair emeritus of the Cardoza School of Law Alumni Association and a past member of their board of trustees. He lives in Ithaca, New York, where he and his wife live happily ever after. And you do a radio show on the same station the Ralph Nader Radio Hour is on, which I'm a part of. Hello there, Howard Leib.
Hello there, David Felton. How are you today?
I'm very good, Mr. Leib. You and I both went to college with President Obama.
Yeah, the last good president.
The last, or maybe just the last president. I don't have time. Go ahead.
We hope not, is what I was saying.
Yeah. So I you know, time moves on, and you and I don't have time for people. You were helping me about 2 years ago. We were going to try to set up some kind of 501c3 that would hold the FCC's feet to the fire and create more low-power radio stations and stop the merger of Universal and, was it Comcast? Not Comcast.
Yeah.
Was it Comcast?
Yeah, it was.
And did that?
And that went through.
Anyway, you're a poll watcher, and you were watching the polls for John Kerry in 2004, and we haven't talked in a while. I don't want to go over what happened. I want to go over what we have to do.
And there are
That's the way we should look.
Yeah. So,
I mean, whatever happened in the past, we'll let other people beat their shoulders and heads and figure out who got it wrong and how. We've got to look forward. For the next 4 years, you know, the federal level is going to be kind of really screwed up. You know, our side can play obstruction, and I'm hoping we will. And, you know, we can get on the case of our representatives if you live in a place with a Republican or GOPR, as I call them in my newsletter, representatives. But there's not a lot we can do there. But at the state level, which is where this all started, there's a lot we can do. If you live in a state where redistricting is being done in a very partisan manner, well, look and see if there's a way to get a ballot initiative on for independent redistricting. In fact, the former Attorney General Eric Holder and President Obama are going to be working on that very issue over the next several years. Holder has started a new movement for sane and fair redistricting. In New York State, where I am, we have an opportunity in 2017 to vote for a constitutional convention.
Okay, so there's a lot you're covering. So let's go into the weeds step by step, because I think a lot of people are overwhelmed. Somebody I know can't get out of bed. Her back went out. And I say, well, you know, maybe if you turned off MSNBC, your back would feel better. So let's talk pragmatically, because you're the person I call when I need advice on how to proceed. So if our listeners, because we have listeners all over the world and we have American citizens all over the world, if you're an American citizen, let's talk on a federal level and then we'll dig down to city and state. Tell me what I can do as a citizen in a red or blue state to obstruct the Republicans in Washington. Right now, what can I do right now? I'm not talking about, I don't believe it's a fait accompli that Donald Trump is going to get inaugurated. So I'm, you know, this is a game of inches. What do we do right now to keep him from getting inaugurated?
Well, you could get him in a Twitter fight. That's easy to do. Might discourage a few electors, but the idea of the Electoral College not voting for Trump, while not 100, while not zero, are small. I mean, these are people who were elected to do exactly that.
Okay, well, talk me out of. There's some stuff that I have to that I'm going through. I keep checking the electoral map, the New York Times interactive electoral map. I keep thinking they're going to find some more votes in Philadelphia. They're going to find some more votes in Michigan. Is there any way, just you need to disabuse me of my delusion, there is no way they're going to find any votes in Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, correct?
Correct. And the odds are so low as to make it not a good use of time to look in that direction.
Okay, so just get me out of this head, because you're a guy, I have a lot of respect for you, because you're a good liberal New York Jew who I've known since I was 18, and your heart was always in the right place, and you walk the walk, and you play the ground game. You know, you went to law school, and you know, you half the time you use your law degree to make money in the silly entertainment industry, and the other half is spent teaching law and going out and monitoring the polls and running for state senate and fighting the ground game, which is the hardest thing to do. So my attempts to count ballots via the New York Times website is a fool's errand. There is no way, when all the provisional ballots and the absentee ballots are counted, there is no way she is going to win these necessary swing states, correct?
Let me put it to you this way. One, no. Two, you're watching it in the New York Times webpage isn't going to change it. It's just like the guy sitting in bed watching MSNBC.
Okay. So I'm going to stop doing that because I trust you. Getting the electoral college delegates, what are they called? What is their title?
Electors.
The electors in the swing states not to vote for Donald Trump.
Well, first off, it doesn't have to be just the swing states. All electors have, I mean, again, I don't think this is likely, but I'll walk you through the process. Because I looked at this process.
Okay, hang on. Hang on. You're smarter than I am, and you know more than I do about this. But I have to control the conversation because this is okay. Because you're teaching me, and we have to learn the way I learn. So, and you are a teacher, and you have a class to teach in exactly a half hour. So, let me ask you these questions. She would need 270 electoral votes.
Correct.
She is about, what, 40 shy? I don't have any.
That sounds right. I don't have the number in front of me, but that sounds right. She got New Hampshire yesterday.
Okay. So it's winner take all, except I think in Nebraska and Maine.
Correct. Where they give out a certain number of electors based on congressional districts.
In those two states. So the issue now is, can you find electors in red states? And you're saying not necessarily swing states. Can you find, say, let's say 30 electors? Is that all it takes?
The law does not, well, the law in some states do not bind electors. Some states do, which means they are legally obligated to go in and vote for who they were elected to, if they're in one of those states. But it's never happened in a situation where it mattered, so it's never been tested. There have been what are called disloyal electors before, but not many, a handful in the history of the country. But if you could find sufficient to change their votes, then there might be an action against them.
Okay,
but the
so okay, oh,
vote
hang on, hang on.
You, still
you,
be binding.
Okay, you have to go slowly with me. Do we know the names of the electors?
They are probably findable.
They are what?
Because people voted for them.
They are what?
It is probably possible to find. I said findable.
Okay.
You can probably find them out. It would not be easy, but it can be done.
Okay, if the shoe were on the other tiny foot and Donald Trump was in the same situation that Hillary Clinton is in, apparently she doesn't think she's in a situation, but would the Republicans be finding out who these electors are and intimidating them, coercing them to change their vote?
I can't say no.
Okay.
I can't say yes. But there's very little I put past them.
Okay, so why is Podesta, why are the Democrats not fighting for these electors? They won the popular
vote.
Because
we're not as slimy.
What?
Because we're not as slimy as they are.
Is it slimy or is it constitutional? She won. We don't believe in the Electoral College, right? We're going to get to that in a second. So I'm asking you, is it slimy to obey the Constitution? We have an electoral college because we don't trust the masses. This is a Madisonian view of democracy where the people can't be trusted to make their own choices. That's why we have an electoral college. It's part of the Constitution. So why don't we work the Constitution? Why don't we work the electors? We have, 60 more days. When do they cast their ballots, these electors?
Very beginning of January, I think, like January 4th or something.
Right. So we have about, 6 weeks. Why is there no effort to work the electors? Find out who they are and work them. That's not sleazy. That's following the Constitution. It's being smart.
You can certainly make the argument. I mean, it is why the Founding Fathers created Electoral College. You're absolutely right. They simply did not trust the masses, meaning us. And, I mean, that's why senators weren't even elected directly. According to what I just popped up, Hillary right now has 232. So you would need to flip 38 electors. That's a lot. Since that would be a multiple of the number of electors who had flipped in the history of the country.
Well, what if there's a full court press? In other words, why is she conceding in less than 12 hours? Why are they not fighting this?
That I can't tell you. You'd have to ask Podesta that one.
Because they don't feel the sting of a Trump presidency. But this is the kind of thing where we have to go in and demand that you start fighting now, not when he gets inaugurated, now. And I'm surprised at you, that you're not thinking this.
Well, let me tell you why I'm not. After the Al Gore debacle, I actually sat down with my computer and started to pull up the Electoral College delegates and such. Because all we needed to do was flip one back then. You know, and then Gore conceded and they stopped. But what I've discovered, and what is the case, is it might be possible, and underline might 400 times, to disqualify an elector or two. There's almost no requirement in the Constitution for who can be an elector. But you do have to be a citizen, and I believe you have to be a resident of the state in which you were elected. And I believe you cannot be an employee of the federal government. I think those are the requirements. And my belief is we are so lax about the Electoral College because we don't care about it, that probably one or two slip by who are employed by the federal government or something like that. But if you don't get to 270, if all we managed to do was get these mythical 38, and it might only be 22 because Michigan still hasn't been called, these mythical electors to say, okay, I just won't vote. I can't vote for Hillary, they say, because they ran as Republican electors. That's not enough. If we don't get Hillary to 270, it goes to the House of Representatives. There is no question who the House of Representatives is going to elect as the new president. And it is not going to be our side.
Well, I mean, look, Arizona has 11 electoral votes.
Correct.
John McCain loathes Donald Trump. He can't help us. In Florida, there are 29 electoral college votes. There's nobody in the Republican Party. Jeb Bush can't get a couple of electoral votes to switch. South Carolina has 9 votes. Is Lindsey Graham South Carolina?
I think he is, yes.
He can't get some people to switch. Pennsylvania has 20. There's nobody. Ohio, Kasich, 18 votes in Ohio. He can't get some votes to switch. I mean, is this guy dangerous or not? Texas, 38 electoral votes. There's nobody in the Bush family, George Herbert Walker, George W. They can't finally do something right?
Do you really see any of that as a reality? That these people are going to step up in a way they have never done before, to do something that has never been done before, in the face of having to, what will be viewed as, do in the party all of these people have spent a lifetime in?
Well, Mitt Romney,
do you really see them putting the country ahead of their party?
There are 6 votes in Utah, where Mitt Romney is from, and he spoke out against the dangers of Donald Trump.
And they still voted for Trump.
That's right. But the electoral, you can, why not work the Constitution? Why are we giving up before the inauguration? Even if you lose, you're sending a signal that we don't accept this and that we're going to fight you every step of the way. Why are you thinking so big when you, right in front of you? And this is the problem with us. Work the problem in front of your nose. And the problem in front of your nose is that in early January, you're going to be the Electoral College is going to validate, normalize a racist, rapist, misogynist who surrounds himself with anti-Semites and shouldn't be anywhere near our nuclear codes. And he lost the popular vote. So where's our ground game? Why aren't we stopping this?
We're not stopping it. I don't think there's anyone who knows, or there's any organized movement to begin this. It hasn't started.
Where are the lawyers? We're the side of the Enlightenment.
This is not about lawyers, David. This is not about lawyers. This is not a lawsuit. This is not you run to court and sue somebody to prevent them from voting for Trump. This is, at best, their friends and family knowing who they are and talking to them and persuading them.
Right, but it requires lawyers. It requires constitutional lawyers to get on the TV, to get a movement going. It requires President Obama, a constitutional law professor, to say, hold on a second. We have a constitution. We're a nation of laws. The only reason this guy is going to be president is the only reason George W. Bush was president. And that is because we have a constitution, the silly Electoral College. Well, it turns out you can work the Electoral College. So he hasn't been...
I'm hearing a very pained primal scream coming from you that I understand completely. But, you know, all these people who are Trump delegates, who at some point ran because they supported Trump, remember that, are not going to be persuaded by President Obama getting on the TV. You might be, I might be, but that's not who the audience is that you're looking to reach.
You know what? You can win a fist fight, but I might throw enough punches to your head that in a year you have CET. I may be down and passed out, and you're the victor, but you have CET. You have plaque in your brain now. Because I punched your head so hard. There are ways to lose, man. You know?
There are also ways to keep fighting.
There are ways... we're not fighting. What is wrong with us? We're rolling over. You have to fight them every step of the way. What is your... okay, now I'm... okay, now. You know more than I do. Let me hear your, and Ralph Nader and everybody has their big grand plan that we had in the year 2000. We were going to make it easier for people to vote, and we were going to, some people said, get rid of the Electoral College. Now, what are the intellectuals? You know I love you. But what?
That's becoming more and more questionable as the discussion goes on.
What is... There's a lot of freedom that comes with stupidity, Howie. You need people like me who don't know what they're talking about. So what is
George Pfeiffer once said, there's no greater power than ignorance.
Yeah. Who said that?
Jules Pfeiffer.
Okay. So you want a constitutional convention?
Well, that's New York State. That's not federal. New York State, every 20 years, puts on the ballot a question of whether we should have a constitutional convention. 20 years ago, the voters said no. 20 years before that, they said yes, and then turned down everything that was proposed. But November 2017 is the next go-round. And yes, for lots of reasons, I think New York State should have a constitutional convention. not the least of which is voter protection issues. And some term limits on state legislatures, and governor wouldn't be so bad either.
And there's this, Ralph Nader's talking about various states joining together to make sure that their electoral, what are they called? Electors in the Electoral College.
Yeah.
Can only,
the Popular Vote Initiative, I think, is what you're talking about.
Right. And that they have to agree that no matter who wins the popular vote, their electors have to vote that way. And that could, you don't need all 50 states. You just need, you know, Ohio, Florida, Arkansas. Not Arkansas. What am I talking about? Indiana, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Michigan, Florida. All right.
Yeah, they would have to change their laws. I mean, right now, I just popped up a site and I'm looking at it. Michigan, North Carolina, South Carolina. If an elector violates what they're supposed to do, they're just replaced by somebody who'll do it.
Or they're fined $1,000 fine.
North Carolina's $500. Oklahoma's $1,000.
What is the fine in Arizona or say Texas?
Arizona doesn't seem to have a provision. I don't see one for Texas either.
Or Florida?
Florida has one, but it doesn't. The sign I'm looking at doesn't specify what it says. It says they're bound by state law to cast their vote for a specific candidate, but it doesn't say what the penalty is if they don't in Florida.
And then is the vote counted? If they're fined, do they still have to count?
Well, again, in North Carolina and South Carolina and Michigan, no. The elector is polled and a new person is put in to cast the vote correctly. Florida, I don't know.
All right. Maybe I'm an ignoramus.
No, you're just angry. You have every right to be.
I mean, she's going to win the popular vote by about 2 million when all is said and done, right?
Last time I saw it was about 700,000, but who knows what it'll be at the end.
Yeah, once California, you know.
Yeah.
Is there any value to the Electoral College because it protects the tyranny of the coasts? I mean, isn't there some virtue to the Electoral College?
The reason the Electoral College will never be taken down is because it needs to be by a constitutional amendment. And you need enough states to vote for it to pass it. And states like Iowa, which makes huge amounts of money every 4 years, and New Hampshire, which makes huge amounts of money every 4 years because of the presidential election, would make nothing because nobody would ever go to New Hampshire again for votes. They'd only go to New York, California, Texas, maybe Michigan, Ohio, states that have voters.
And so
the small states will never vote for it. It's not in their interest.
So
either economically or in terms of political power.
So isn't there a virtue then to the Electoral College? I mean, isn't this a war, a football game that requires brilliance? And doesn't this serve as an indictment of Hillary for not being able to win a ground game? I mean, don't we want a president who is smart enough to win the ground game, to know? If you can't figure out how to beat Donald Trump in the Electoral College, are you really that great a mind?
I this goes against what we said we were going to do, which is look back and see what went wrong.
I'm wondering if it's worth the effort to change the Electoral College. Maybe it's to go into Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Wisconsin and Texas and figure out why they're so red.
I think there's a lot of truth in that.
You know, what do we do instead of trying to get rid of the Electoral College, which is a fool's errand? I do like this idea of the popular vote initiative, you know, forcing electors to go with the popular vote. That seems easier than a constitutional amendment. I mean, I've heard, you know, Public Citizen, which I love, they want a constitutional amendment to overturn Citizens United. And it's like, give me a break. You know, forget the constitutional amendments. It's never going to happen.
The Citizens United would be easier than the Electoral College.
He should not have won this election.
No, he should not. And we're going to suffer for it for a generation to come.
And when you say generation, do you mean like from W to Obama?
I mean for the next 20 to 30 years, because he's going to appoint a Supreme Court.
Right.
I have 10 minutes left, my friend.
All right, give us marching orders. Tell my listeners what to do.
Every 4 years, we all get really excited and focus on the presidential election, and then the majority of us disappear for 4 years. That's our biggest mistake. It's the mistake the Tea Party didn't make. The Tea Party organized and stayed organized, vigilant, and fought every day of every year. If we're not willing to do that, we're going to keep losing. We need to organize at state and local levels. We need to build our way up and take over state legislatures. 2020 is not just the next presidential election. It is the next legislature that will set up the voting districts for Congress as well as locally. If we have not taken over legislatures across this country by 2020, we have another decade of the same stuff coming at us, because we will never take back the House of Representatives. You need to organize at that level, at a congressional-level district, in order to get congressmen elected. You need to organize at a state House level in order to elect state legislatures. That last is so important, and no one pays attention to it. If your listeners do nothing else, start looking at your state legislatures. It's where real change can happen, and it can happen fast.
Well, I just looked up something. The Democrats won the popular vote in the Senate.
And in the House, too.
Again, in the House. Yeah.
We won the popular vote everywhere. The House, however, we don't win because of the way it's districted. That's one of the things that your state legislature will change in 2020.
Yeah. This is interesting. This is according to USA Today. So far, 45.2 million Americans cast a vote for a Democratic Senate candidate. 39.3 million Americans voted for a Republican Senate candidate, and yet the Republicans control the Senate.
Because the states where we win, most of the time, we win overwhelmingly. The states where we lose narrowly. There's a lot of what is called in the literature wasted votes.
Now, according to Town Hall, is this true? This is Town Hall. It's a right-wing rag. As the left grapples with Hillary's shocking electoral loss, many are voting, pointing to her popular vote as a victory. Let me just see here. They keep popping up. This can't be right. That they lost Congress, the popular vote for Congress?
Who lost the Republican, the vote for Congress?
According to USA Today, Republicans, they're quoting, Town Hall is linking to an article in USA Today. And they say Republicans captured the majority of the popular vote for the House on Election Day.
Collecting
about 56.3 million votes, while Democrats got 53.2 million, according to USA Today calculations, with a few races still undecided. So this is an example of Town Hall, a right-wing rag. Yeah. So they're linking to a false story.
Or they're just making it up. Mr. F., I have to run.
We'll talk later. Thank you.
I'll talk to you soon.
Bye.
Bye, everybody.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.